What's up, bud? How you doing, man?
Hey, man. How are you?
Doing well, doing well. Good to be here, bud.
Fine.
Oh, yeah, I've been...
Hi, Patrick. My name is Andres. I will meet later. I am so glad to be here with this group.
I'm excited to be here, too. Nice to meet you, Andreas.
Hey. Nice to meet you.
How you doing, bud? Oh, there we go.
Fine, fine. I'm fine.
Es cool tener la oportunidad de poder conocerte, Patri, además observando lo que es el tema del stand out. Me parece increíble, o sea, como la actitud, esa personalidad que manejas, y me gustaría, o sea, conocer un poco cómo describiría su temática para que el público se adapte a la situación y pueda disfrutar.
Okay, Patrick, it is great for us to interview you because it's amazing to know about the field of the stand-up comedy. John wants to know what is the thematic or how do you prepare to put the audience in the contest that you are doing some stand-up routine?
So how do I get them involved when I'm doing comedy and stuff?
Yes, in your routine.
Oh, okay. Well, what I like to do, I try to be very engaging. I like to ask the audience questions. I'll have the same jokes from show to show. I mean, I'll change them up. But I like to have a dynamic approach to how I set them up or how how I do them. For instance, if I got a joke about a guy hooking up with his girlfriend, you know, I'll ask a guy in the front row if that's his girlfriend. I'll go in that way. Or I'll ask people if they agree with something, and then I'll go into a joke. I like to talk to the audience a lot and make it a more interactive experience, as opposed to me just going on stage and doing the same jokes every time.
Okay, John, esto... Dice que le gusta engaging, es algo así como unirse, por así decirlo, como atraer al público con preguntas, entendiendo también que pues las bromas o los chistes que él prepara pueden estar sujetos a cambios. Entonces, por ejemplo, si en la primera fila hay una persona saliendo con su novia, pues intenta involucrarlo en la rutina. Entonces, digamos que es más como una dinámica de que las preguntas lleven a que la audiencia haga parte de la rutina y que no sea simplemente pues una persona contando unos chistes, unas bromas que ya haya preparado.
Oh, eso es increíble. Además, se me surge como esa idea de en que, bueno, estás en el escenario con determinado número de personas. Es decir, es importante que usted, Patrick, rete esa mentalidad del público, el hacer reír, o basta con solamente entretenerlo, porque hay ese clase de personas que solamente quieren reírse, pero no procesa bien el tema. ¿Usted qué idea usted toma para que eso conecte entre ambas?
Okay, this is a tricky question.
All right.
Patrick, do you challenge the audience to make us laugh in some way? Or
make a what? Make a what in some way?
Laugh, reír.
Okay.
Or you just go with the flow and you do your routine, not expecting some kind of reaction, understanding that in the audience, there are some people that wants to laugh, wants to entertain, be entertained, but right. sometimes they don't know how to react in
right,
some
right.
part
they're
of
not into it.
Yes, I got you.
So in a situation like that, it's kind of a common trope for comedians that whenever you see 20 people, 19 are laughing, having the best time of their life, but that one person isn't laughing, you're like, I got to get that one guy. I don't know how I'm going to do it. If I am doing my routine, my set, and it's not working, I will deviate from that and I'll start maybe doing some other stuff to try to get them on my side. Because I've been in that situation where, like, you know, aspects of the audience don't necessarily find you funny. And that's, you're not connecting with them. So you've got to kind of call an audible, right? And figure out a way to, you know, connect with them in a different way. Because comedy is a lot like sales or communicating, you know? That's how I approach it. That's how a lot of successful comics approach it, at least from what my understanding is. So I don't want to make like everybody like, what's the word I'm looking for? Defensive or anything like that. I would like to make everybody laugh, but also I understand sometimes that's unrealistic. To be honest, if there are times like when 95% of the audience is having a great time, 5% isn't, okay, that's fine. Hopefully they still pay me and hopefully they still have me back, but I can't, you want to make everyone laugh, but there's always going to be some people who just don't really, they don't vibe with what you're doing.
Okay. John, a veces en un recinto con 20 personas, 19 están sintiendo, digamos, la comedia y siempre va a haber una persona que no está conectándose. Lo que a Petrit le gusta es cambiar un poco esa rutina y aceptar ese reto, que ese reto generalmente es el que asumen los comediantes, de lograr que esa persona se conecte. A él no le gusta que el público esté a la defensiva. O sea, el público como de, bueno, sabemos que nos vamos a reír, entonces debemos reírnos. Entonces, generalmente, él entiende que la comedia es como la comunicación o como las ventas. Pero pues él dice que generalmente, cuando a veces el 95% de la gente reacciona y ese 5% no, pues él entiende que igual como comediante le están pagando y que sigue simplemente la rutina. Pero que claro, ese es el reto, la comedia, ¿no?
Y no solo eso, Andrés. O sea, en Patrick, claro, él explica que solamente hay una persona como que no se siente como que capaz como de poder analizar el contexto, porque puede ser casos, sí, que le hayan sucedido, o puede ser experiencia. Entonces, es importante que juegue, o sea, es el rol del lenguaje para que esa persona tenga la capacidad de, por lo menos, decir, me puede pasar. O de pronto, eso juega mucho en él, o juega mucho en lo que visualiza de la persona, como tratar de cambiar el rollo.
Ok, está complicado, pero ya entiendo tu punto de vista.
Sí.
Patrick, what is the role that the language or the, I don't know, the visual or the oral communication plays in one routine to engage, let's keep the previous question, engage that person that is right, not feeling it. Do you use the oral language or the visual aspects? I don't know. What are those tips or those kind of on verbal and non-verbal aids that you use?
I get what you're saying, Andres. You're killing the game, by the way, my man. You're killing it right now.
It's John, the one that is killing it. I just translated.
Yeah, both are. Are you translating? I was like, this guy's getting everything I'm saying. You guys, I'm happy to be on. You guys, good to finally meet John face to face as well. I just think we've been talking a little bit.
Okay.
So what I try to, it's interesting to say that. So I don't necessarily use a lot of visual cues, as more as I make sure I enunciate. You know, I make sure I'm very animated when I speak. And it's kind of like when, if you can't, in order to really engage people, I'm not going to jump around and do jumping jacks on stage. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going to try to be animated. I'm going to believe in what I'm saying, and I'm going to say what I'm saying with conviction, right? So when I do that, that's me doing my best to get that person who isn't interested in the show. But if I just, like, you know, if I start acting like a wild man and doing like pro wrestler stuff and, you know, throwing up muscle poses and whatnot, that can work sometimes, but that's something that's going to have diminishing returns to your overall development as a comedian. In my opinion, you want to verbally engage the audience as much as possible, as opposed to relying on a physical cues. Cause like, you know, some guys, it's a common thing. You'll see them like hump the bar stool. Right. And that's usually something that's considered, it's kind of looked down upon because it's a lot of people do it and it's just kind of a hacky thing to do. So I want to make sure that I speak with conviction. I connect to the audience. A lot of times a trick I use, and it's a trick you would use like in sales or just any kind of communicating, is I'll look you right in the eyes and I'll speak to you. And that will elicit a response, because most people don't have the balls to just like stare at you and stone face you. You know what I'm saying? Like you kind of trick them into responding.
That you don't do jump treats, that you are very animated with the stuff that you are doing. Okay.
Right. Right.
So that was the last thing.
Yeah. So I try to be as verbally interesting as I can. And a trick that I like to employ that's also used like in a lot of sales tactics or even interpersonal communication. And it really works really well on stage. So if you look someone right in the eyes while you tell your joke, you're almost forcing them to respond. People feel uncomfortable staring right at you and stone facing you, like not reacting at all, unless they just completely hate your guts, which happens too. But for the most part, you know, you want to use as many tricks as you can that don't involve you acting like a complete jackass, jumping up and down on stage and stuff like that, you know?
Dice que estamos siendo asesinos con esas preguntas. Yo le dije que el asesino eras tú y que él dice que te gustaría, le gustaría sentarse frente a frente y que la entrevista fuera más cercana para que hubiera ese reto. Entonces dice John que estás rompiendo con las preguntas. Dice que nada, que digamos que uno de los errores más comunes en la comedia es que cuando, digamos, te está perdiendo esa persona, empiezas a saltar, te empiezas a volver muy físico, y digamos que Patrick no opta por eso, él opta más por ser, mostrarse animado. Listo, tú tienes tu rutina, tú te la sabes, y tú demuestras ese ánimo, porque muchas veces mirar frente a frente a la persona que no te está, o sea, digamos a la persona que no te está copiando, hablando así en castizo, puede atemorizarla. Entonces dice que siempre usa de ayuda esa forma animada de hablar para no caer, digamos, en el ridículo, por así decirlo.
Eso es una muy buena respuesta. Además, obviamente la experiencia es más enriquecedora cuando es cercano, ¿no? Pero esta es una de las maneras más eficientes, bueno, a través de la distancia, poder disfrutar. Y yo le agradezco a Andrés por esta oportunidad. Además, Patrick, lo más importante de que, bueno, en un comediante de Estados Unidos, ¿qué diferencias, tanto positivas y negativas, pudiste notar en los estados que has conocido o que de pronto ha salido de donde vives?
Ok. Patrick, the audience and the type of comedy, knowing that the United States is a very big country, changes in every state. John wants to know every time that you travel, I don't know, far from the place that you are, do you notice some changes in the comedy and the type of comedy of the another standard comedians?
Tell me. I'm in Houston, right? Mm-hmm. But every scene has a different kind of feel and a different kind of comic, you know? Some places are a little bit more real. Other places have more absurd comedy. Mm-hmm. But even like in Texas, like the type of comedy that audiences want to consume will differ if you're in a large metropolitan area like Houston, whereas if you go to like a smaller town or a mid-sized town away from Houston, right? Mm-hmm. So if you're going a little bit maybe outside of town, they may not be normal comedy fans, right? So you got to throw, you know, some more relatable or not as high, you know, they want to talk about having fun, which is like, you know, we're having drinks, talking about hooking up with chicks, maybe doing mm-hmm. drugs. They want to talk about having a good time. And then maybe your interpersonal struggles. Whereas if you're inside the city, you might be able, it's a different feel because there's more comedy fans there, generally speaking. So you could do more high concept, weird jokes. You know what I'm saying? Like non sequiturs or like interesting puns, whatever you want to do there. But comedy will change depending on where you're at. And also it'll change depending on how big the scene is. So Houston comics, in my opinion, are pretty sharp, and they're very good because they have to perform in front of all types of different people and all kinds of different venues. So, Houston is the third most diverse city in the entire United States, behind I think it's behind New York and Chicago. Mm-hmm. I might be mixing those up, but we're a very diverse city. So we have to come across a lot of different people's point of views and a lot of different walks of life. And that really sharpens your comedic point of view. And the same thing happens. Like, so if I go to Louisiana, where they may not have as big of a comedy scene, right? I stand out a little more because I'm able to go up in front of so many different people and get up as many times that my skills are sharper, right? So it's a little bit, it's a little bit easier when you go to maybe a smaller city. Now you still have to prepare and take it seriously, but Houston can be a pretty tough place sometimes to do well in. So when you do well, it's very satisfying.
Okay. Bueno, John, la cuestión es que Patrick, pues, es de Houston. Houston, bueno, aquí dice que se arriesga, ¿no? En el sentido de que Houston es la tercera ciudad más diversa de Estados Unidos. Dice que con Nueva York y probablemente Chicago, dice que espera no cometer un error en ese dato. Y al hacer comedia en un lugar tan grande, con varios tipos de cómicos, se entiende que al ser diverso, la rutina tiene que, digamos, como que ser más aguda, por así decirlo, o sea, no contar los chistes de solo divertirnos, que son los que entretienen más a la gente de pequeños pueblos, como Luisiana, por ejemplo. Entonces, dice que cuando él va a otros pueblos, la gente, pues, se divierte más fácil, por así decirlo. O sea, puede contar chistes de, bueno, aquí menciona, ¿no?, de drogas, que, pues, eso es increíble porque pues, en Colombia es complejo ese tema, ¿no? Acá no se puede. De drogas, de nada, de salir con chicas, pero cuando está en un lugar más grande, entendiendo que hay muchas formas de ver la comedia, y bueno, tú sabes muy bien que has visto stand-ups, que en Estados Unidos la comedia es algo complejo, muy complejo, entonces esto entiende que al ser una audiencia muy diversa es muy complicada, pero eso le ha dado las habilidades para él volverse más sharp, es como más afilado, o sea, como más agudo. Entonces, buenísimo ese dato, porque nos enteramos que la audiencia de Houston es buenísima y es dura.
Yo me quedé, o sea, impresionado así con lo que dijo Patrick, porque bueno, hay tipos de personalidades cuando uno es más libre en el libreto, sí, en el monólogo, por así decirlo. Y también es importante conocer desde la opinión de Patrick es ¿de qué parte va el éxito de un comediante de stand-up en el que hay varias personas detrás que te influyen a ser un comediante de alto nivel o es un tipo de trabajo duro? O sea, que diga, la luché, pero aquí estoy.
Ok, déjame ordeno porque es una pregunta compleja. Dale. Patrick, this is a tough question. John is an assassin today.
Okay.
What, in your point of view, of course, what are the ingredients to become or to endure to be a great comedian? Is it, are the, the people that you admire, knowing that I was talking that with John, that in the United States, there are so many types of comedy, or are the background that you are performing that make you a stronger comedian? I don't know. It's a tough question, but.
Andres, can I ask you a question? What's the biggest sport in your country?
The biggest sport is soccer, football.
Soccer, okay. Right. So it's comedy. I'm a big sports guy. So I approach comedy the way you would approach sports or like lifting weights. Okay. And you want to respect your influences and what inspired you to do comedy. But like you also have to realize like you have to form your own unique point of view. Like I don't want to be a copy of one of my favorite comedians. I want to be Patrick Eady. I want to be the best version of Patrick Eady I could be. And the only way to do that is you have to write. I write every day, write down thoughts or journal entries or jokes, whatever comes. Cause like, comedy's writing's a big part of it. And also it's getting on stage as much as possible. Ideally, I try to get on stage 7 to 10 times a week. I'd like it to be more. But because we still have some corona restrictions here, it's not as open as it was. But to be a great comedian, it's the same way to be like a great pro athlete or a great musician or a great anything, is you have to put the work in. You have to be consistent. The formula isn't hard. You know what I'm saying? The X plus Y plus equals Z. It's like, if you put the work in, you can be great, but you have to be consistent over a long period of time. It's like that idea where in order to truly master something, you have to put 10,000 hours into it. So in my opinion, if you get up as much as you can, if you write every day on a long enough timeline, if you stay consistent, you put the work in and you believe, then you can become great. But it's a long, arduous process. But anything that's worth doing is hard, and so is being a great comedian. It's a tough road, but it's something that I love doing. It's something that I want to be. So in my opinion, you got to get up on stage as much as possible, write every day, and also be a good person off stage, because that's your reputation. And your reputation is a very big thing. That's how you get more shows. That's how you meet more people. But you want to be a real hard worker and be consistent.
That's a great answer. Thank you. I will translate. John, aquí te voy a responder, pero del final al principio. Vale. Digamos que son tres reglas para Patrick. Escribir constantemente. La comedia es un ejercicio de escritura. Él escucha noticias. Él escribe, cosas que le surgen, pensamientos. La segunda, y este dato te va a gustar, es estar en el escenario. La mayor cantidad de veces. Dice que él está 7 de 10 veces a la semana en el escenario, y que pues al haber restricciones con el coronavirus, pues obviamente esto ha disminuido, pero él está 7 de 10, o sea, en 7 oportunidades en la semana se presenta, de 10, wow. Y la tercera dice que ser una buena persona, el ser fuera del escenario. Eso te consigue más shows, eso te consigue más personas por conocer. Cuando yo respondí que fútbol, es porque él me preguntó que cuál era el deporte que más gusta en este país, y él dice que hay que respetar y entender que existen muchos tipos de comedia, que existen, digamos, héroes, pero que él no desea ser la copia de algunos de estos comediantes. Él desea ser Patrick y la mejor versión de Patrick cada día. Así que, al igual que los deportes, es el entrenamiento. Dice que la fórmula no es compleja, pero sí es complejo el trabajo que se tiene que poner para llegar a ser un buen comediante.
Uy, esa es una buena respuesta, Patrick. Increíble. Además, yo estoy imaginando, Patrick Es un chico de trabajo, bro. Está muy claro. Ahora, además, lo más importante, Patri se considera comediante de mayor escritura o de performance. O sea, ¿cuál de ellos dos o ambos? Porque hay personas que le gusta es aquel que narra el cuento y aquel que lo interpreta.
Ok, creo que ya sé la respuesta, pero igual le voy a preguntar. Ok, Patrick, I think I know the answer here, but it's great to know. Ok, do you consider yourself more a writer comedian or a performative comedian in the aspect that, ok, this is why Johnny said, some comedians prefer to tell the joke, you write and you tell it. And other comedians wants to perform that joke, to act in some way, to become a character, so to do that joke. How do you consider yourself?
Well, I will say when I first started, the performance aspect came naturally to me. I was very animated on stage, and it took time for the writing to catch up to that. Now, I'm still trying to become a better writer, but I like to consider myself a writer comedian. I enjoy writing. It's a lot of fun because you start digging into your own thought processes and you start learning a lot more about yourself. And then when you start learning a lot more about yourself, you connect to the audience much better. So at this point, like I'm better at performing than I am writing, but I'm trying to get my writing up to par where I can, be as clever as I can. But I consider myself a writer, a comedian. That's what I like. I like writing the jokes and going out and performing them. Writing jokes is a lot of fun.
Ok. John dice que cuando él comenzó sus rutinas, la parte del performance venía natural. Él tiende a ser muy activo en el escenario, pero él se considera un comediante escritor. Un comediante escritor escribe constantemente. La escritura es un proceso importante para su trabajo. Dice que eso sí que a veces el performance es muchas veces mejor que la escritura. O sea, como que es una opción, pero que su naturaleza es la de un comediante escritor. O sea, en resumidas cuentas, es un comediante escritor que es muy bueno haciendo el performance porque siempre es activo en el escenario.
Oh, increíble. Patrick, lo más importante que uno prepara el monólogo y lo presenta ante el público, le puede gustar. Y el público le queda, o sea, ya en la mente, puede ya uno referenciar, pero ¿cuántas revelas de ti mismo en su comedia?
Ok, Patrick, how much do you reveal of yourself when you get out on stage? I mean, how much of Patrick the person is revealed after a standoff with the audience?
It's a good question. It's a good question because it's something that I've been working on. I've been doing comedy for about 5 years. When I first started, it was hard for me to kind of open up on stage. I'm kind of starting to dig into my own, personal issues, family stuff, and explore that on stage. Now, admittedly, I'm not gonna let the truth get in the way of a good story. You know what I'm saying? So I'll play some aspects up, but I've been starting to incorporate more of myself into my comedy because a lot of times I would get people would say, "Oh, Patrick, you're just kind of like a joke machine. You're just like joke, 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 joke." But when it's over, I still don't know who you are. And that didn't used to bother me, but at the same time, I'm starting to, like I've gotten to a point now where I feel like if you watch a 15-minute set of mine, you get an idea of who I am as a person and you learn more about me. Because when you open up and you share more about yourself, kind of like what's the word I'm looking for? It's kind of like you're hey, let's I'm relating to you, I'm opening myself up to you. So people want to be more on board. And comedy, like good comedy, is when you're authentic, you're able to speak to something that everyone can relate to. So when you and a lot of and you realize it's kind of cathartic that a lot of people go through the same issues that you go through, the same feelings, And then when you open up and you share that, it's a much more rewarding comedic experience.
Okay, I will do a question by myself and I will translate the both. Because okay. That reminds me, sometimes I watch some stand-up from the United States. I don't know so many, mm-hmm. but sometimes I watch. And that reminds me that kind of comedy that Neil Brennan do, that he's a man that reveals so much from himself that even doesn't become comedy. It's a tragic stand-up. So
right.
That's a spot that you don't wanna get. Reveals so much that type of comedy that can be harsh for the audience and of course for the comedian.
I think that if that's what you want to do, I don't necessarily feel the need to do that now. That doesn't mean I won't feel that later on in life. I feel like, you know, Neil Brennan, you said, correct?
Yeah, the Three Mics is called. Yeah,
I've seen it. I know he's very hilarious. He's a great stand-up and a great writer. But as far as that's kind of what his artistic, that's what he wanted to do. And some people use comedy to bring up very intense social issues or personal issues, and they bring that to light. Another good example is a comedian named Patton Oswalt. He talks about his wife passing away on stage. It's a very like heavy subject matter. But I'll never limit myself to what I want to talk about on stage. Funny is funny, you know, but if you bring up a very serious, heavy subject matter, then it's got to be really funny. Otherwise, you kind of just, people are just kind of depressed. So I'm very much in the thought, like whatever the artist wants to do, as long as it's funny, as long as it's well-written and it's, you know, it comes from a good place. Like, cause like a lot of times the best way to deal with traumatic or really heavy things is laughter. Mm-hmm. Right. You know, my parents are still alive, but if my parents died and I wanted to talk about that on stage, that's a very heavy subject, but if I have a good turn on it and it's funny, then I would talk about it, you know? And that's also a good way to deal with those real heavy subject matter. I personally don't necessarily have anything in my act that's real, real heavy like that, but I have things in my life that have happened that are like a very, you know, tragic or what have you, but I don't necessarily talk about those on stage because maybe I haven't processed it enough personally to make it funny, but I would never say I'll never talk about that on stage because when you're writing and you're trying to figure out what's funny, sometimes you can think of, hey, I can relate to people this way and this is funny, even though it's a painful experience.
Thank you, man. Great answer. I will translate both.
No problem.
Dice que se ha tenido que enfrentar a esa situación donde, digamos, alguna persona del público le dice, hey, Patrick, tú cuentas una broma tras una, bueno, un chiste tras un chiste tras un chiste, pero no revelaste mucho de ti. Dice que eso a veces puede ser esto, pues, un pain in the ass, un dolor en el trasero, pero que él poco a poco va a empezar a agregar aspectos de su vida en la comedia. Lo que pasa es que él dice que no se siente cómodo revelando esos aspectos de la vida, que existe un tipo de comedia que sí lo hace, y que entonces yo le hice una pregunta, que no se acercaría a ese tipo de comedia como la que hace Neil Brennan, el de Three Mics, que pues el tipo cuenta cosas personales que llegan a ser muy trágicas, ni siquiera son muy cómicas. Dice que, bueno, que él le parece un buen comediante, es un buen escritor, y que dice que si llega a pasar una situación trágica, si la comedia se convierte en un proceso de sanación, por así decirlo, él lo haría, pero solo si en realidad esa historia llevara un elemento cómico que llevara al público a reírse. Dice que no quiere deprimir al público, pero que poco a poco está generando ese aspecto de involucrar más aspectos de la vida en su comedia. Entonces, una duda, pregunta y una doble respuesta.
Eso sí, hacer eso al mismo tiempo. Además, yo dije, o sea, le realicé esa pregunta a Patrick porque de algunos stand-up que yo he visto, ya sea de Latinoamérica, pero más de Estados Unidos, Hay una incógnita. Para hacer reír de verdad, ¿se necesita ser honesto o simplemente dar alguna, o sea, alguna frase o algo que salga de una vez? O sea, sí escrita, pero que salga así de lo que se le vino a la mente.
I translate some of the things that you asked before. Do you want to?
Yeah. I can repeat it.
Okay.
I can repeat it. Yeah, I think the best is a mix of both, whether it's absurd or honest comedy. I think doing both is it's what I like to do. Mm-hmm. I try to even some of the things I'm honest about, I'll add some absurd elements because that's what I enjoy. I like jokes mm-hmm. more so than people just kind of bearing it all on stage with like a funny anecdote. So I think a good answer is both. It's like music. You know what I'm saying? Led Zeppelin's great. So is Black Sabbath, but I don't think either one is like a definitive end all be all. So I think the best show is a good combination of both.
Okay. John dice que la mejor, que le encanta escribir jokes, chistes. Que, pero que siempre tiene una mezcla de ambos. Dice que le gusta lanzar chistes o anécdotas honestas, pero con situaciones absurdas. Dice que no es el tipo de comediante que se desnuda en público, o sea, me refiero, que cuenta todo, sino que le gusta contar bromas, a veces que sean honestas, pero siempre con algún final absurdo o algún desarrollo absurdo.
Eso es. Una muy buena respuesta. Le tengo dos preguntas al tiempo y al final, bueno, culmina Andrés para que culminar la entrevista. Patrick, en el fondo, sí, me encanta su personaje, o sea, su representación, porque yo viéndolo, a algunas personas les parecerá como el típico chico rompecorazones, me refiero al tema de, sí, del corazón y todo eso, pero yo veo esa un personaje que muy bien se puede construir para poder hacer como una película sobre creando su propio personaje, todo, pero yo lo vi y yo dije, wow, este tipo tiene algo especial, es decir, tiene algo que el pensamiento de él es único, o sea, él tiene como el conocimiento de poder interpretar la vida, pero a través de su propio, o sea, de su propio yo. Y me gusta mucho, esa es la primera pregunta, o sea, que me gusta mucho y qué le parece que en algún momento de algún futuro pueda crear ese personaje. ¿Sí? Okay, y la segunda, nomás, es cómo hace para desarrollar la voz, porque la voz que tratas de hacer en el stand-up no es la misma que está real, obviamente, pero cómo haces para que esa voz sea muy, muy precisa, acorde a su personalidad del personaje.
Voy a empezar con la segunda y después finalizamos con la primera, que vale. Es la... Okay, these are the two final questions. The first one, how do you work and develop your voice? Because listening and watching your routines, the voice is not the same that you are using here in this interview, there is some development, some different use of your voice. So how do you train it, develop it, create it on moment?
Okay. Well, on stage, I'm just kind of like a wild version of myself. It's like an uninhibited stream of consciousness throughout my material and like what I'm doing. But in here, like, you know, I'm a little more measured. I want to make sure I answer all the questions as authentically and as carefully as I can and give you a good idea of what my thought process is. But on stage, I'm just, you know, kind of, I'm just rolling, man. I'm just kind of like, I know my jokes. I know what I'm doing. I'm confident. I'm having fun. And it's kind of just like a more, it's a more wild version of myself, but it's also a very true version of myself. Here, like when we're just kind of talking, like, you know, if I'm like how I am on stage, it would be kind of overbearing and it would be kind of like, oh, this guy's kind of an asshole. you know, I'm not really enjoying this conversation. Whereas for is when I'm on stage, I'm the only one talking. I'm moving fast. I'm being a real grand gestures. I'm making like a lot of different, you know, do a lot of different things. But when you talk to people, especially in podcasts, I try to be a little bit more measured, you know, to put a more concrete, definition. When I'm on stage, I'm like at 10-10 of what Patrick is. But here I'm kind of more like 7 or 8. You know what I'm saying? I'm taking the foot off the accelerator a little bit because, you know, we're talking a lot about, you know, my thought processes and how I approach stand up and everything like that. But when I go on stage, I try to be the most uninhibited, wild version of myself that I like to do. You know, I like to have a lot of fun on stage. But when I do podcasts and things like that, depending on the nature of the podcast, I'll try and match the energy of what that podcast calls for. You know, so if you were asking me these questions and I was acting like how I was on stage, I don't know if it would come across as genuine. So I try to be genuine for whatever the moment calls for.
Okay. And the final question got to do with this answer. So this is a prize from heaven. When John saw that poster that is behind him, he thought that some people will say, "Oh my God, the character that Patrick is portraying is some heartbreaker." In Spanish we call it galán. Some protagonist of a soap opera, the macho, you know, and going. But he saw a character that with so much confidence, and he thought, "Oh man, this can function." He, John, is a filmmaker. Me too. Small filmmakers, but we are filmmakers. He thought, "Oh man, that character can be played. Can be played." The question is, have you considered yourself to perform the character that you're doing on the shows? I don't know, in another media, like a film, I don't know, that to take those characters off the stage and or the Patrick 10-10 take it to another stage because he got so much presence.
Sure. All my focus is now, because I have a day job and all sorts of stuff. So basically stand up is my other job and I kind of put all of my other resources into it. But at the same time, I am always trying to think of ways I could do, you know, different things like in a video medium, you know, or being more entertaining that way. And I am trying to move more into that where I can kind of do more comedy that is like, in a visual medium, like TikTok, Instagram or stuff like that. To be 100% honest, I haven't been quite as inspired to do that as I am to do stand-up. Uh-huh. But I realize that's an integral part of like growing a fan base and getting more people interested in seeing me on stage. So yeah, I do think about, hey, how can I kind of take this off stage, be my own, have my own genuine sense of humor and like bring that out and start like, you know, doing different avenues. Cause that's kind of what you need in today's like stand up like stratosphere to get better is like, you need to have all these other mediums cooking at once. So I'm definitely brainstorming ideas, thinking of things. I haven't acted out on them yet. Because to be honest, I want my stand-up comedy on stage to be just as sound and as strong as it could be. Mm-hmm. So all the writing that I do, if I write something that's kind of really weird and obscure, sometimes I'll just put it on Facebook just for like shits and giggles, just have a good time. But yeah, definitely I'm gonna try to. This next year, a goal of mine is to do more stuff where it's just like videos and more stuff online where I'm just kind of being myself and being funny, but not only doing stand up. I'm definitely looking to diversify what I offer to audiences.
Okay, just late. Thank you. Bueno, John, lo bueno es que sí te va a responder la primera y después la segunda. Esto dice que cuando le comenté sobre el personaje, dice que. Si está pensando, digamos, como al otro año, diversificar un poco más, porque pues él se está participando en TikTok, en Instagram, Y por ejemplo, a veces en Facebook coloca algún chiste que digamos no va a compartir el escenario, pero pues como para generar como risas instantáneas. Pero dice que si busca seguirse diversificando, llevando digamos a otro terreno, solo que él se siente mejor llevando ese personaje al escenario. O sea, que es un comediante de escenario 100%. Dice que obviamente él entiende el uso de medios para el 10, para crecer la base, la base de fanáticos, pero, y aquí respondo la segunda, la cuestión es que Patrick, el Patrick que está en el escenario es el Patrick 10-10, o sea, es el Patrick llevado, se pone así como mismo acá en éxtasis, llevado a la última potencia, casi en un estado mental. Entonces él dice que si escribe una broma muy zurda o muy tétrica, él va a reflejar eso. O sea, él, por eso es que usted ve esa presencia así en el escenario, es porque él se deja llevar por ese Patrick, pero que cuando es el Patrick de podcast, de entrevistas como la que está acá, él lo lleva a un 7, a un Patrick 7, porque dice que, por ejemplo, si usara el Patrick que está, digamos, respondiendo ahora, no generaría, digamos, como el mismo impacto que genera el escenario. Tiene que llevarlo a la última potencia, al 10, llevar la voz. O sea, no es que esté haciendo una voz distinta, es que es esa personalidad de él en un estado mental que lo lleva a ese 10-10. Entonces ya por eso es que...
Con razón.
Claro, esa es toda la razón. Le voy a decir, John says that, ok, that's the reason why the Patrick 10-10 is on stage.
Dile que yo veo la representación de él a como está en la foto y a como yo he visto actualmente los videos que me enviaste por Messenger, o sea, así como el estilo, como, no sé, tejano o algo, me agrada totalmente porque es un chico que rompe los esquemas.
He says that when he saw the videos and he saw this poster, he said that with the big mustache, and he said that it's some kind of breaking boundaries, breaking skins from him. But I think because the comedy here in Colombia, I will not answer this, but in these days, what do you consider, or what are the advices that you can get to the comedian here in Colombia? Because in Colombia happens one scandal, the decade before that one man that in prime time he just saw doing the blackface, and in Colombia the people still thought that was funny, because we don't know, I know, but the people, the general audience don't know the history of blackface. He thought that, oh, that's a funny man that tries his selling in black, because here we had the slavery, but wasn't that heavy as on all the things that made that the United States don't use blackface. So what are your advices to comedians here to evolve? Because the comedy in Colombia is so... I understand it's a cultural thing. Of course, mm-hmm. We have the comedians, but happens things like that. We still have it doing comedy that is sometimes racist, sometimes
right.
Is I don't know, man. I think in Colombia this has to stop, because we are showing it in prime time in 7 a.m.
Right. Well, I think it's one of those things where even like 20, 30 years ago in America, people were doing some material that was pretty offensive, mm-hmm. and even like, you know, derogatory towards groups of people. But as the art form evolves, you move more and more past that. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will complain in America that like political correctness is like ruining comedy. I don't necessarily think that's true. A lot of times like racism and things like that, it's a very like common denominator kind of thing. And it's a very blunt tool that some people will use. And it's kind of looked down upon here for good reason. Now there are ways to incorporate your experience, like there's a lot of there's a way to incorporate your experiences through your own culture of expression that aren't racist, but also tell where you've come from and how to relate to people. And that's like, and that comes with the progression of the art form of stand-up. So I think with time, that stuff will be phased out because it comes off as just kind of derivative. Mm-hmm. And we would use the term hacky. Like a lot of people have already done it. It's not really funny anymore. It's an old hat. You know what I'm saying? It's like if a new band came out and said, check out our new song. And they played Smoke on the Water or like some other famous song. It's like, what the hell are you doing, man? That's an old song. We're past that now. And also too, I don't personally, like, you know, all the comics I'm friends with, like, we don't really do comedy to demean people or piss people off or be shitty towards people. You know, you want to make people laugh, you know? And I mean, there's a fine line between being edgy and being offensive. Like, you can come up with like a controversial opinion, but if it's funny and you have good reasoning behind it, that's one thing. But just being like overtly racist or being mean, like very mean to a group of people who have already gone through a lot, it's not funny. It just comes off as like you're being kind of a jerk. And a lot of times it's kind of like you're showing like your own internalized feelings. Like if somebody comes out with a lot of derogatory jokes to one group of people, you'd be like, oh, I think that guy's kind of a racist because this is what he thinks is funny. But like there are ways to talk about cultural differences and there's ways to talk about different forms of cultural expression that are not racist and that can be funny. And that's what we should focus on, you know? And I think that comes with just the evolution of the art form, especially in Colombia and in different places, or maybe stand-up is still, is stand-up relatively new in Colombia? Has it been going on for like a while?
It happens, I think, like 20 years from here. It's relatively new. It's relatively
new. That's so even like when stand-up first started in America, which I want to say the 40s or 50s.
Yes.
And that was like because mafia guys wanted entertainment in their clubs, right? So they would have guys up there. And it's like, oh, take my wife, please. And they do all that stuff. And it was, and that's funny stuff. And some of it still holds up. But even moving past that, there was some guys who were just like doing crazy shit that you wouldn't do now. It's just kind of considered mean. But back then, it was like the cultural norm. So you can get away with it. And some people would enjoy it. But as culture evolves, the art form evolves as well. And that's not a bad thing ever. Yes. You could be funny without being a prick. You could be funny without being, you know, mean to people. And you could even have very interesting, maybe contrarian opinions, but you have to make that funny and make me like, you know, I have to be with you in your point of view. So I think that stuff will change the longer people do stand up and the longer that the art form evolves there.
Okay, I will translate, but I will tell you this. In Colombia, there are two types of comedy. The stand-up that is relatively new and it's kind of evolving. And the old comedy that we don't call it the stand-up, we call it, in the translation will be tell jokes. Not stand-up, but tell jokes. When the cheese is and there, yeah, that's the title comedy that one guy goes, this guy as okay, we'll say hillbilly or a cop, and do one routine but dress in a disguise. So he's that's the two types of comedy that we do here in Colombia. Okay, I will translate. And there is a third one that is more from the street. That is called the Tell-Taylor, the Cuentero. That there's people that are writers and share their stories, but their stories had some funny elements.
Okay. That's mostly, cool. I had no idea.
Yes, mostly are people from the universities and they are really high.
Yeah, I like that. I think it's cool that they're staying up there. And I mean, I like learning about stand-up and all its little like nuances and stuff. And I mean, I don't really know a whole lot about Colombian culture. So this has been very informative for me, my man. It's pretty cool.
Okay, man. Thank you. I will translate. Esto, bueno, John, le dije, yo sé que lo escuchaste mucho. Es que le dije que pues en Colombia se presentó algo la década anterior, pues el caso de Micolta, ¿no? De que fue censurado por el hecho de que él se puso pues pintura negra y que él no lo vio como una broma pasada, pero pues obviamente él desconocía pues la historia del blackface, ¿no? De la pintura negra. Entonces que yo le dije que qué consejos tendría para, pues, para los comediantes colombianos, porque seguimos haciendo una comedia muy, muy atrasada, de hecho. Entonces él dice que se puede ser gracioso con temas ofensivos desde que eso lleve a una reflexión. Pero pues que si eres un estúpido que está pues metiéndose con una, pues con un concierto, digamos, grupo social, pues en realidad el problema pues es el tuyo, ¿no? Con ese grupo social. Dice que pues en Estados Unidos el stand-up existe desde los años 40 y que comenzó con la mafia. Que los mafiosos querían pagarle a un comediante para hacer chistes como que, hey, me llevaré tu mujer, pero pues de repente sucedían cosas que culturalmente eran bien vistas y ahora no. Entonces eso tuvo que evolucionar. Entonces él me preguntó que el stand-up desde cuándo está en Colombia. Yo le dije que desde hace 20 años. Después yo le comenté que es que acá existen otros tipos de comedia, ¿no? Que es el cuentachistes, el stand-up y pues el cuentero. Dice que bueno, que eso le encantó aprender sobre eso porque no conocía mucho de esos aspectos, y él dice que no, que naturalmente la comedia en Colombia va a evolucionar y tiene que evolucionar, que si tiene que va a llegar un momento en donde hacer la comedia pues misógina, la que siempre se hace en Sábado Feliz, ¿no? La comedia misógina o la comedia machista y racista, la gente la va a dejar de parecer graciosa, o sea, como que, hey, ya me has contado ese chiste. Entonces dice que no, que es cool y que eso va a evolucionar. Amazing.
Espero que mejore para cambios positivos. Eso es importante. Además, Patri, dinos tus redes sociales para que la gente pueda seguir en constante movimiento lo que haces.
Ok, Patri, no more from these guys. Tell us, please, on your social networks so people can follow you and get some likes.
All right, sounds good, man. You can follow me on Facebook at Patrick Eady, E-A-D-Y. I'm also on Instagram. You could type in Patrick Eady, or you could type in Coors Light Poppy 713. That's CoorsLightePi 713. I also have a YouTube channel where I post different clips of my stand-up. I do crowd work and stuff. And I just want to say, John, Andreas, thank you for having me on. I've really enjoyed learning about, you know, different things in Colombia and your different culture and stuff like that. And it's really cool that I get to talk to people from a different country. I really enjoyed this experience, guys. And thanks a lot. I really appreciate it.
Está en Facebook como Patrick Eady, Eady. Está en Instagram igual, pero también está como con una especie, creo que es el show de él. Entendí que era Course PI, C-O-R-R-S. Y está en YouTube subiendo pues constantemente sus stand-ups o... Get
ready, son lots. Gracias,
Patrick. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you, guys.
Encantado. Muchas gracias por la oportunidad. Thanks, un abrazo y espero que pronto lo mejor para usted.
The best wishes, man, and hot.
Thanks, guys. I really appreciate it. Hey, you guys, take it easy. Talk to you guys soon, man. Love you guys. Appreciate you. Y'all take it easy. Bye, guys.
Bye.